Our story today takes place maybe 100+ years ago in the Stanley Mountains of Papua New Guinea. Now, the mountains might be a little bit like what we have here, where we're at in the Smyrna Valley. All of us are familiar with that, except they would be much taller, and they would expand out wider, and they would be really compressed together, up and down, and there'd be a little spot that would flatten out where you could have a village. Just kind of like Granny Ann's little orchard might be a little village tucked into these Stanley something mountains in Papua New Guinea. And so one little village would be built right in a little apple orchard about the size of Granny Ann's, and then they would clear some land out further on to plant their gardens. And over the mountain would be another tribal village. And a little over 100 years ago, Faole was born in one of these villages deep in the mountains there of Papua New Guinea. And he was born into a family and into a village that had a long history of cannibalism. That means they fought the villages over the mountains, killed people, brought them back, and ate them, except now things were a little more civilized. They weren't cannibals anymore, but they were still headhunters, and they still fought one another, and they still killed each other for no reason at all. In fact, the men were not even considered available for marriage until they had killed their first person. So Faole was born into this family, into this village of fighting, tribal warfare all the time. He was 15 years old on this particular day and going out hunting with his older brother. They left their village and they were hunting boar or something else. Oh, I should tell you that these mountains, and I tell you in case Auntie is listening, these mountains were full of parrots, beautiful parrots, plus all kinds of other wildlife. And so Faole was going out in the mountains hunting with his older brother, and they came across a man who was tending his garden, not of one of their villagers, but someone from somewhere else out tending his garden. And Faole thought, today's the day. And he threw his spear at this man, but he missed. And the man was unarmed, so he started to run away, but Faole was faster, cut him down with his machete, and had his first kill. And this only started a life of wickedness for Faole. Soon it was another man, then a lady, then a baby, and then some more people. And Faole's reputation was evil, and it spread through these mountains up and down over in the villages. Everyone feared Faole because he was fearless and he didn't care. And one day he and a younger brother were out after his mother had died, and this had made him even more angry and upset. And he killed two men, and his younger brother killed a third man. And now word was getting back to the government officials, and they sent out a party, an official party of policemen and government authorities looking for Faole, and they took off through the jungle, but they were caught and brought back and questioned. And his younger brother got away, but Faole was there, handcuffed. And the magistrate or whatever was asking him, did you do these things? And Faole admitted, yes, I did them. Faole was honest. He was a bad person, but he was honest. And while they were questioning him, he saw a key on the ground. And he realized it was probably the key to his handcuffs. So he sat on the key, thinking, later on, when I'm by myself, when they leave me here, I'll unlock my handcuffs and get away. And he sat there on them, everyone's scurrying around looking for them. Finally, he decided, if I don't tell about this key, my brother, who is a good man and on the police force, he will probably have to pay for my getting away and escaping. And so he turned the key over to the person in charge, and that person was so amazed that this feared Faole, this bad murderer, would turn the key in. And so he talked some more with Faole, and Faole said, told him, you know, everything. He owned up to everything, and the official said, "You are a bad person, Faole. I'm sending you to the county district or whatever is for sentencing." He said, "You're bad, but at least you're honest." And so they sent him away to the judge. And the judge heard all that Faole had done and said, "Faole, I have no choice but to sentence you to hanging. You deserve to hang for what you've done." But something happened in the course of things that instead of being sentenced to be hung, he was given a prison term, and he was sent to prison. And do you know what? Faole became one of the best workers in the prison. He was a friend. He became a friend to the jailers. Everybody liked Faole. You know why? Faole at least was honest, and he was a hard worker. Yes, he had done terrible things, and even after he was released from prison, he stayed by and worked for the jailer. The jailer liked him, but the call of the mountains drew him, and eventually he left on foot, up over and over and down and over, until deep into the mountains to his home village he returned. Well, about this time, 2 years earlier, the Adventists came to Papua New Guinea. They came to the coastland. They didn't go deep into the mountains, but they built a mission station close to the mountains. And they were building and had planted things. And one day, not soon after they got established, this wild-looking man came out of the mountains. He had heard that the missionaries paid people to work for them. So he came looking for work at the mission station. And somebody whispered in the missionary's ear, "Don't hire him. He's a murderer. He's Faole." And he said, "If you hire him, everyone else will leave for fear. You can't hire him." And so the missionary said, "No." Faole left and went back up into the mountains. 20 years passed, and then the mission station decided to build an outpost in the mountains. So for a whole week, they hiked up and down and over into the mountains to Ifobi, a little village in Ifobi, and built a mission station, built a little school. And you know, out of the mountains came a person and said to the missionary, "I want to go to your school." They whispered in the missionary's ear, "Don't let him come. This is Faole. If he comes, everyone else will leave because everyone is so afraid of him." And the missionary said, "Oh, Faole, you don't want to come. You're 40 years old. You'll be sitting beside first and second graders who are learning how to count and write their ABCs. You don't want to do that." Faole said, "I'm coming to your mission school." And the missionary realized he couldn't change his mind, so he gave Faole a plot of land as far away from the missionary school, but still on the station, where he could build his house and plant a garden. And Faole came to the school. His house and his garden were the best of anyone's. He kept it neat and clean. He had a beautiful garden. The other people came and looked over the fence. "This is Faole, the dreaded murderer. Look at his house. Look at his garden. Actually, he's kind of a friendly person." And they all came one by one to look at Faole. He had changed. We don't know how, except God spoke to his heart. He was an honest man, and God can speak to honest people, and a change came over Faole. Well, to make a long story short, he became friends with the missionary. He learned well in the school, and they decided to build another outpost. Faole was the person they chose to go with them. Now just think, everyone feared Faole. You would like to have Faole by your side if you're going deep into the jungles to people who are still headhunters. And so Faole went. They established another mission, and it became a beautiful place. Neat, orderly, loving, kind, pleasant place to be because of Faole's example. Well, over the mountain in the next village, Makabe, the chief died. no reason. He wasn't sick. He hadn't been wounded in battle. There was no reason, so the elders gathered around. There has to be a reason for the death of our chief. It must be McCabe and all the things they're doing. They're leaving the spirits and they're worshiping a different god. We're going to go over the mountains and destroy that village. Pardon me. And so they got their war party together. But one person in the village said, I like what's been going on in McCabe. I don't want them to destroy that. I wish our village was like that. So he left immediately, 5 days' journey to the coast to tell the mission authorities what was planned, that Faole was going to be killed. In the meantime, the party left and went on foot to McCabe. And at McCabe, they were having evening worship. Faole knew something was wrong. Danger, pardon me, was in the air. As soon as worship was over, everyone scattered and disappeared for no reason. For once, Faole didn't know what was going on. But they were gone, and he sensed something was up. And he opened his Bible, and he leafed through his Bible, and he came to Psalm 34:7, which says, "The angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him." Faole prayed and said, I'm sorry, Father. I doubted and was afraid. Please keep me and my family safe." And he went to bed and slept through the night. Meantime, the other guy made it down to the mission authorities. They got right on track, came up to check on Faole. A week later, they found him, and they said, "Faole, we were told you were dead. Where were you doing a week ago this time?" And Faole said, "Well, a week ago, something was up, but I prayed and claimed the promise of Psalms 34:7, and nothing has happened. And I think I'm going to close the story now and tell you what happened, the rest of the story, next week, about what happened to that war party that came over to destroy McCabe and what really happened to Faole." But to close our little story today, you know, you might think, we're not headhunters. We're not cannibals. We don't go out and kill people. We're not like them. And of course, this ties into our Sabbath school story where Saul is trying to kill David. That was thousands of years ago. But today, in our world today, we have one gang fighting another gang for trivial reasons. People die, drive-by shootings, sometimes just to do it. And our world is no different than the world of Faole. It's true that he was in the wilds of the jungle, so to speak, and we live in civilization. But when Satan rules, our hearts are black, and we hurt other people without even caring. But when God comes in like he did with Faole, he changes us, and we become loving and kind and patient and willing to help one another instead of destroying one another. Thank you, and we'll finish up next time. Happy Sabbath, everyone. We were going to finish our story about Faole. Now, if you remember last Sabbath, we talked about Faole. And he was a wicked man in his little village in the mountains in Papua New Guinea. And his family were not cannibals, but they were headhunters. And to prove his manhood, he had killed people. And he found out that this was exciting, and he liked to do this. And his reputation spread to all the villages around him, and no one wanted to be near Faole. And if Faole was coming close, they got out of the way because they weren't sure if their life would be safe around Faole. Well, the missionaries established a mission station on the coast, and Faole came down. Remember, he wanted to work at the mission station and make some money, but they turned him away because if Faole worked there, no one else from the local people would stay. 20 years later, a school was established. Faole came. He was in his 40s. He wanted to attend school and learn to read, and they wanted to send him away, but he said he wasn't going, and he stayed, and they gave him a plot of land in the far edge, as far away from the rest of the people as possible. But Faole had changed. He made a beautiful home, planted a beautiful garden. People started to notice that he was kind of nice, and they enjoyed being around him. And they sent Faole into the mountains, the missionaries did, to establish another outpost for the Adventist mission, up and over and up and over and deep into the mountains. And a little spot was cleared for Faole and his house. A nice, beautiful garden was planted. His house was the nicest around. And he began to invite people over to share his garden food. And he shared Jesus with them. And the village started to clean up and get shipshape, and they treated one another well. Well, remember, in a neighboring village, the chief died. And there was no reason why he died. He wasn't sick. He hadn't been wounded. Nothing happened to him. And they figured, in their way of thinking, that a curse had been placed on the chief. And it came from Faole in the next village, where he wasn't worshiping the spirits anymore. And they decided to put together a war party and creep over in the darkness of night and kill Faole and the rest of the villagers. Well, one guy got out and got to the missionary on the coast and told him about it. But in the meantime, the war party left, all dressed up in their finery with their spears and machetes, and left for Faole's village. And when they got there, Faole had sensed, remember, that there was danger in the air. Everyone else disappeared, but Faole stayed in his hut, and he claimed the promise in Psalms that the angel of the Lord encamps around about them that love and fear God. And so he claimed their promise, went to bed, and woke up the next day. Nothing had happened. And this village, this neighboring village that had come over, the group of people had left and gone back to the village. And in the meantime, the missionary came up and said, "What happened to you, Faole? We heard that you were killed. What's the story?" And Faole said, "I don't know what happened. On that particular night, we claimed this promise and went to sleep." And so the missionary decided to go to the neighboring village. And when he got there, he found all the men were sullen and angry, and all the women were laughing at them. And he couldn't figure out why. And he asked the new leader of the village, "Well, what happened? I thought you were going to Faole's village." And the new leader was angry and he wouldn't talk. And the missionary said, "I need to know. Did you go to the village or not? What happened? Why wasn't Faole killed like we heard that he would be?" And finally, the new head of the chief, and I want to tell you it in his own language, he said, "At last the man, shaking with anger, said, 'You plenty savvy where dis fella manny stop.' The missionary replied that he didn't know and asked again where this headman had been. And the headman reluctantly admitted that he and his fighting men had gone to kill Faole and the rest of the villagers. But quivering with rage, he shouted, 'You gammon too much, you plenty savvy. Me no savvy fighting white man. You look him plenty teacher along you all in white lap lap stand along roundhouse Faole ye all time.'" And what he meant, what he was saying is, "You know why I didn't do it. How could I kill Faole when you and a lot of other men dressed in white stood in a ring around his house all night?" And so God had sent his angels. Now the wicked villagers thought it was the missionary, a group of missionaries had come up and were protecting Faole and his house, but it was angels that were protecting Faole. Faole continued to live as a Christian there in the village. But soon World War II broke out, and the Japanese were coming close to this group of islands. And Faole realized that danger really was in the air, and he took he and the orphans he was caring for out into the jungle and set up a hut to live in safety there. But Australian Allied forces were also on the island, and there was this group of Australian soldiers that were cut off from the rest of their company, and they were behind Japanese lines. And try as they might, they couldn't break through to get back to their company. And they finally tried day after day, night after night, and were blocked every time. And finally, they decide the best thing we can do is live here in the jungle the best way we can. And they tried to find a place in the jungle to live. When they came to a little clearing, and a hut was in there, and they heard some people talking in the hut, but they couldn't understand them. They thought, these must be Japanese. We better stay, be careful and stay away. And then they heard this song in English that said, "Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go." And it was Faole and his orphans having evening worship. And Faole came out and talked to the soldiers, and the soldiers said, "We're caught up from our line, and one of our men is wounded badly." And Faole took, and the rest of the orphans took care of the man, and who eventually died. But the leader of the Australian soldiers said, "Can you help us get back to our company of soldiers?" And Faole said, "Yes, I can help you." And so they took off on the trail. Faole and the Australian soldiers and the orphans coming behind, sweeping the path of their footprints, trying to find the company of Australian soldiers that these stragglers needed to hook up with. And day after day, they kept looking. They got hungry. They were tired. They were forced to eating berries, which no self-respective native would do. But that's what they had to do. And finally, Faole said, and I have to get it in his own language. He said to the soldiers, "Me sorry too much. Me lose him way altogether." In other words, he was lost. The men felt as if the bottom had dropped out of everything. They were hungry, they were tired, they were in despair. But listen! Faole is asking them to gather around him and kneel down with him while he asks. "Im big fella marsta, im e stop long heaven, im e tell pickany, belong im which way e go." The officer personally told me, and the author of this is Reuben E. Hare, personally told me, "I felt that this was the right and proper thing to do, and as we knelt in the jungle and that old man prayed, we knew that it was all right. We could not understand what he was saying, but he did seem to be on very intimate terms with that God to whom he was appealing so fervently. Something happened to me, and not only to me, but to the rest of the boys also. We were sure that Faole had everything arranged with his God, and that we would be all right." And they were. Faole got up from his knees, turned around, and headed in the opposite direction than what they had been headed in. And within an hour, they met the Australian company, and the stragglers were able to connect with them. God answered Faole's prayer. The men didn't understand what Faole was saying, but they knew he knew who he was talking to. And for those people who don't know God, for our children who may have, like Sister Arlene said, lost their way, have forgotten what they've learned, if they only knew the God of heaven who answers prayer just like Faole's prayers were answered, all problems would be solved and we would walk with him. And so I'm thankful for these little missionary stories. We hear them over and over, how God answers prayer, but they're true and they help us to be grounded and strong in our God who is powerful and can do all things. Thank you.